In 1994, two like-minded individuals founded a video game company with the goal of creating the next generation of interactive entertainment. By combining Hollywood artistry with rock-solid gameplay, they aimed to produce emotionally rich experiences that would leave a long-lasting impression on those who played them. A shared universe, with pathetic yet relatable protagonists, whose plights mirrored those of real-world people and cultures that had been ruthlessly ransacked by greedy profiteers throughout history. Taking place on a bizarre alien world far away, and steeped in a dark sense of humour to hide its overtly political messaging. A company whose sheer grit and determination resulted in a series of critically acclaimed titles that were unlike anything the industry had seen before. A company called Oddworld Inhabitants. Oddworld Inhabitants was founded in September 1994 by visual effects and computer animation specialists Lorne Lanning and Sherry McKenna. Lanning began his career as a classically trained painter, having attended a school for illustration, fine art, and photorealism in New York, before becoming introduced to the world of 3D computer graphics in the 1980s. He was so enamored by the possibilities of the technology that he decided to attend the California Institute of the Arts, where he graduated with a Bachelor of Fine Arts in character animation. This eventually led him to the award-winning Hollywood visual effects studio, Rhythm & Hues, where he worked on feature films, advertisements, station indents, and motion-based attractions. It was here where he first met his future business partner, Sherry McKenna, a client from Universal who he worked with on creating motion-based theme park attractions. Straight away, Lanning knew she was a serious producer with incredible insights and skills, having first been made aware of her through various television specials in the early 80s. She was the go-to person in computer graphics whenever the press wanted a story. After persuading her to work at Rhythm & Hues, Lanning proposed the idea of co-founding a video game company together. At the time, they'd been working on motion-based simulator attractions, which turned out to be a great preemptive experience for making video games, as they were already used to working within the constraints of current-day technology to create fun user experiences. However, McKenna wasn't interested. Undeterred, Lanning spent the next 2 years trying to convince her. He eventually won her over when, one day at her home, he told her a story about a character called Squeak, whose body parts had been repossessed by animal researchers called the Vikers, with what little left of them being stuffed inside a clunky robotic form. He told her this story in the context of a larger five-part epic, what would come to be known as the Oddworld Quintology. Prior to the founding of Oddworld Inhabitants, Lanning had spent around 6 to 8 years writing a compilation of stories which became the genesis for Oddworld. Frustrated by the injustices happening around the world, he'd write stories about unlikely heroes set in realistic yet fantastical environments that were embedded in the issues that were bothering him at the time. While disjointed from one another, the themes of these stories were consistent enough that they seemed to coalesce into one massive epic with a shared universe. It created the framework for which all Oddworld characters, environments, and storylines would be built upon. More specifically, the plights of these characters mirrored real-world injustices inflicted by corrupt profit and powermongers throughout history. Prejudice, starvation, pollution, deforestation, all of these things were happening on Oddworld too. As a staunch anti-capitalist, Oddworld exhibited strong anti-consumerist messaging. Lanning wanted to create characters that were at the bottom of the food chain, so that the audience could identify with them. He tried to make it humorous for both the victims and the guilty, in an effort to disguise the strong political messaging. That way, he could get his philosophy across without hitting people over the head with it. He envisioned Oddworld as a planet that was roughly 10 times the size of Earth, in terms of acreage, with the creatures that lived there being called the Inhabitants, in what he described as the Muppets meets the X-Files. Novels like 1984 and Brave New World had a huge impact on his life, which likely influenced Oddworld and the stories he created. He was also inspired by the people who had built quality entertainment universes, like George Lucas, Jim Henson, and Walt Disney. Each of the five games in the original Quintology would have focused on a new central character, and by the fifth game, you would have had five primary characters all at once. Though each game was intended to stand out on its own, so that you didn't need to play them all in order to enjoy the latest title. McKenna was completely captivated by his story and wanted to turn it into a movie, but Lanning insisted that they create five video games instead. The reason being that a movie would cost hundreds of millions of dollars, and trying to find someone willing to finance it was going to be extremely difficult. but they might be able to secure $25 million to make 5 video games at less than $5 million apiece. McKenna eventually caved and agreed to start a video game company with him, providing he found the money to do so. After putting together a business plan, they tried to secure an investment of $3.5 million, but no game publisher would bite. In the end, they found a Colorado businessman called Gary Vickers, who agreed to fund the project in exchange for majority ownership of the company. After some stern negotiating, Lanning and McKenna managed to convince him to take a 49% stake in the company instead, as it was vital that they maintained majority ownership of the Oddworld brand. With the deal signed, they began setting up shop in Los Osos, California, where Vickers already had a studio called Alexandria Inc. They first stationed themselves next to Alexandria, however they soon moved their offices to San Luis Obispo, alongside many of Alexandria's staff, after the company was merged into Oddworld Inhabitants. With their investor and office space secured, the next step was building the team. Lanning recruited one of his former Rhythm & Hues co-workers, Stephen Olds, who was brought on as a production designer. They also began hiring animators and CG artists out of Hollywood, while bringing on programmers and designers from the games industry. Lanning quickly started piecing together the narrative of the story, so that they could put together a prototype to sell to a publisher. In January 1995, production began on the first game in the Oddworld Quintology, originally titled Soulstorm, then changed to Oddworld Inhabitants Epic 1, starring Abe, and later changed again to Oddworld Abe's Odyssey, at the behest of their future publisher. Before any of that could happen though, they first needed to build a prototype. They'd put together a bit of an engine, so they made the first level of the game, along with the opening cinematic. Lanning knew that to sell things in a pitch, you not only needed to prove that you had a viable product, but also a magic moment that demonstrated something that hadn't been seen before. In the case of Abe's Odyssey, that magic moment was a story told in higher quality CG than anything seen in games at the time, and then dropping the player into the game seamlessly from the cinematic. This was easier said than done, however. Syncing the video playback with the gameplay proved difficult, as they ran at different frame rates, and they had to render the game screens at half NTSC resolution just to fit it all into memory, but once they got it working, everyone was completely blown away by it. Inspired by cinematic platformers like Prince of Persia, Another World, and Flashback, they decided to make the game in 2D rather than 3D. Amusingly, they got the money for Abe's Odyssey based on their 3D expertise, but Lanning always knew they were going to be making a 2D game. The technological capabilities of current-day consoles meant that utilizing real-time 3D would compromise puzzle complexity, animation quality, and background fidelity. They didn't want a low-poly world to establish the Oddworld universe, so they decided to build all of their assets in 3D, and then pre-render the bitmaps for the game. They took a film-like approach, aiming to improve their animations and sound effects to a level not really seen in video games at that time. The decision to use flip screens instead of side-scrolling was decided very early in the development process. Side-scrolling platformers felt too gamey and Mario-like, and weren't as serious as they wanted Abe to come across as. Flip screens, on the other hand, made the world feel more stable, and it focused more attention on the lead character. It also made it feel like locked-off shots from a film. More importantly, McKenna, as a non-gamer, could play it, because the pacing was up to her. Alongside their prototype, they created another one simultaneously, featuring Abe and Elam, a trusty steed with an attraction to honey, who'd get stuck by food traps that the player would have to get him out of by knocking down bees' nests. They also had characters talking to each other in a superficial way, which they called game speak. Instead of walking up to a character and opening a dialogue box, they had the player throw out words, like punches, which made you feel more intimately connected to the world and its characters. The idea of GameSpeak came about as a result of wanting to create characters that felt less like a piece of artwork moving around, and more like living life forms. They knew that if they could make the Modokans feel like pets, there would be an emotional attachment between them and the player. But when they first got GameSpeak up and running, the conversational exchanges were happening too fast. They needed to build in pauses so that it felt like the characters were actually listening and responding appropriately. They also had very little memory to work with, so they could only have one sample file for each spoken word. They needed to mess around with the pitch and other audio processing effects to make it sound as though you were meeting a variety of people and not just the same one. The voices themselves were provided by Lanning and other members of the team, similar to what Jim Henson did with the Muppets, with the person controlling the puppet also providing the voice as well. It was also more cost-effective to do the voices themselves within the studio, rather than hire Hollywood talent. They needed the flexibility to re-record anything whenever the need arose, and Alling feared that if they used Hollywood talent, their agents might turn around and say that they're not available to re-record, or ask for absurd amounts of money for those retakes. With humour being a central part of the game, the team made sure that there were increasingly funny ways in which the Mudduckins could die if you failed to rescue them. This was influenced by vaudeville acting. During the silent film era, actors typically put on exaggerated performances to convey what was going on, and the team realised that's exactly what they needed for Abe's Odyssey. They brought in that similar kind of slapstick humour, and tried to find funny ways for characters to get whacked, like Wile E. Coyote and other Looney Tunes characters. The character of Abe was inspired by the diamond miners of South Africa. De Beers Diamond Consortium had completely destroyed their culture to enslave them into poverty, and generations later, nobody seemed to have any recollection of what had happened, or that it was still happening. This, alongside other historical accounts of indigenous people's land and culture being ruthlessly harvested by privateers, became the backbone of Abe's story. At a design level, Abe was a hero that you didn't strive to be, but more likely someone you could identify with on a personal level. Lanning and Olds talked extensively about Abe before pencil was ever put to paper. They didn't have a particular image in mind, except that he should have a visually downtrodden and underpowered presence. His physical posture should be poor, his walking gait humorous and naive, and he should provoke sympathy when looked upon. After a great many iterations, a three-quarter view nailed the energy and emotional quality of Abe. His skin colour was inspired by fish, as Lanning had noticed while fishing that the same species of fish could look completely different depending on the quality of water it lived in. He later learned that if that fish was put in better water, over time it would change back to its original colour. So Abe and his fellow Mudduckins at Rupture Farms were given sickly skin tones with shriveled ponytails. From a design standpoint, Abe's colours were meant to draw the eye without seeming artificial or cartoony. The coolness of his tones made him inherently unthreatening and disarming. Early iterations of Abe's skin colour included white with cheetah spots. His stitched mouth came about due to Lanning seeing Abe as being more sensitive than the rest. In indigenous cultures, androgyny is more sacred, so he always saw Abe as a more androgynous character that had a higher sensitivity to the natural world around him. Being born in a factory meant he cried a lot. So much so that his mother was faced with the dilemma of shutting him up, or else he was going to be chopped up for disturbing the peace. So she stitched his lips shut so that he wouldn't be hurt. An act of love that brought about a brutal action. Abe's name was derived from Abraham of the Old Testament. In the Hebrew version, he was the father of monotheism, but it was later discovered that this was plagiarized from the first true father of monotheism, King Tut's father, Akhenaten. So nothing is what it appears, and the lies and distortions of history leave a piece of truth so distorted that the original context can no longer be found. This suited Abe to a T, given that he was trying to find out who he really was, and what he should believe. The naming process had its ups and downs though, with Abuman, Abraham Law, Aben, Prophet, and Monkfish all being considered as possible names for Oddworld's first hero. As for the game's story, it was initially going to start with Abe working as a fisherman, living off the land with his pet Elam, before being thrust into an industrialized slave environment. Lanning's desire for Abe's plight to mirror that of real-world people meant the original backstory needed to be changed. He decided to place Abe straight in the factory to help players connect with his predicament more quickly. Lanning and McKenna felt very strongly about things like environmentalism, mysticism, and anti-commercialism, which helped shape the narrative, world, and characters of the game. Lanning was always struck by the hypocrisy of corrupt corporate leaders, who seized the wealth of the people and the land they governed as a means to promote their goods to an ignorant public. The PR and advertising for these companies was always so wholesome and innocent, while in reality, their systematic genocide of indigenous cultures and murderous practices escaped public perception. It seemed appropriate then for Oddworld's corporate authority to be represented by happy-faced logos and career-climbing incompetent middle management. It also hadn't escaped Lanning that there were decent people all around the world who were involved with work that was ultimately affecting everyone in destructive ways. He had previously worked in the South Bronx, in the fruit and produce terminal, for the entire New York tri-state area. As he drove through the city, or took the subway, he'd see hungry people everywhere. At work, they'd routinely dump tons of cantaloupes off the edge of the dock due to some business practices and legislation about what was acceptable methods of dealing with excess. He would watch cantaloupe juice run through parking lots, inches thick, and be hit by the irony that people were starving right outside the gate and they weren't allowed to give them any of this food. Meanwhile, the fast food industry was destroying rainforests in order to produce beef and soya, the latter of which being grown only to feed the cattle. In light of this, they chose to portray Abe as just a guy doing his job, chopping up paramites and scraps, without knowing the harm it's causing. Like countless others, he was hatched from an egg in Rupture Farms, where labourers were born, raised, brainwashed and exposed to closed-circuit television that misinformed them of everything. Unaware of anything different, despite coming from a beautiful culture that used to be indigenous to the area, a culture that knew how to live with the land. Abe lived in the antithesis of that, working in a place that's wiping out all of the creatures they used to coexist with. A roofless factory that he believes is a great place to work. For the game's cinematics, Lanning decided to narrate them in rhyme, like a classic Dr. Seuss children's book. His mother had green eggs and ham read to her as a child, and she later read it to him when he was a child, and he wanted that same kind of timelessness. The team had reached a milestone. They had their prototypes, which looked more like a vertical slice, despite the fact that a lot of the underlying game wasn't built yet. And now they needed to find a publisher, because their investor relationship had started going south. Gary Vickers' investment hadn't been a quick turnaround, and he wanted out, so whoever came in was going to buy his stake in the company. In May 1996, during the second ever E3, the game was shown behind closed doors, but nobody turned up. They had an unknown franchise from a brand new company, with a character who had about as much machoism as a packet of mayonnaise, so it was no wonder people were disinterested, or so they thought. The team went to lunch, just as a few people had started to trickle in. When they got back, the line was around the corner. Word of mouth had spread, and the reception to the game was phenomenal, but they still needed to secure a publisher. By this point, however, they'd created enough buzz that publishers had started taking notice. Activision, EA, Rockstar, and a handful of other publishers all showed interest in the title, but it wasn't until they received a letter from Bernie Stolar, the then president of Sony Computer Entertainment America, when things really started moving forward. McKenna knew Stolar, and they were thinking about publishing with Sony, so this seemed like the perfect opportunity. However, it wasn't meant to be, as it turned out that Stolar was leaving Sony to work with Sega on launching the Dreamcast. So instead, he suggested they sign with GT Interactive. They were an up-and-coming publisher that was well-financed, but what really set them apart was their policy of allowing developers to retain their intellectual property. So under Stolar's advisement, they signed with GT Interactive in September 1996. Of course, signing with a publisher didn't magically make the game's development any easier. Building the company, the game's engine, and the game all in one budget was excruciating. If it weren't for McKenna's relentless optimism, the team likely wouldn't have been able to prevail through all the hardship. One aspect of the game that the team got a lot of flak for was its save and checkpoint system, which forced players to restart difficult sections of the game upon death. It's not as if they weren't aware of this themselves, and they did try fixing it right up until the very end, but they simply didn't have the time, and their save code was pretty convoluted. They also ran into several design challenges due to preconceptions some members of the team had about what made a game good. One example was with Lanning's insistence that Abe should never carry a gun, which some of the more experienced game designers on the team found idiotic. They were trying to build an action-adventure platformer where the main character didn't have much action. This led to all kinds of arguing and infighting. Lanning pointed out that if Abe had a gun, then he was going to solve every problem with said gun, which would make all of the puzzles redundant. So they needed to come up with a creative solution to this problem. They knew that Abe was the remnant of an indigenous culture that was mystically connected to the land, and had powers often associated with shamans and voodoo practitioners. From that line of thinking, the team realized that if Abe was going to use supernatural powers, then he could possess other characters, and if he could do that, then those could be the characters wielding the guns. Before arriving at this outcome, they thought about other ways Abe could possess things. such as being able to take over machines or a control center and then remotely controlling something else, but they lacked any real personality and were limited by where they could take place. It wouldn't have made sense for a control center to be in a natural environment, for example. The team also ran into its fair share of technical problems. They went to enormous efforts to hide and speed up their loading times, which was another point of contention among some members of the team, because traditionally people didn't bother. You'd load the level, play the level, and you're done. Abe's Odyssey, by comparison, had considerably faster load times, thanks to them continuously streaming content, and their use of FMV transitions hid certain loading screens altogether, though few people seemed to notice. They also built an audio engine that tracked the player's actions and dynamically changed the music to what was happening on screen, and even embedded audio cues to provide players with hints. This was something they had to fight Sony to include, as part of the PlayStation spec required them to add a flag that would allow users to turn the music off. Lanning refused, because unlike other games, they weren't just layering the music on top of the gameplay, they were tailoring the music to the action. Unsurprisingly, a number of features had to be changed or cut from the game entirely due to technical and time constraints. Meeches were one such example. The first decent footage Lanning saw of the game, early in development, was a pack of Meeches chasing Abe. There were around 20 of them, and their movements felt so creepy, it was great. By the time they'd gotten deeper into the game, however, the Meeches no longer held up, and they were struggling to fit everything into memory, so they made the decision to make them extinct instead. Incidentally, this memory limitation was also why Sligs and Gluckens never came into contact with Scraps or Paramites. Their characters were so richly detailed that they couldn't have more than a few of them on screen at any given time. They also cut a scene from the cinematic that plays after Abe breaks out of Rupture Farms. Originally, they were going to show a meteor strike hitting the moon, which slowly formed the hand, implying that there were greater forces behind it and that they were sending Abe a sign. However, it made more sense to leave it out and have the moon be an enigma. Another change was with possession and game speak, which were both originally intended to be learned by the player, but they realized that they needed to start off with something much more unique to hook people in, and so they changed it so that both abilities were available straight away. As for the game's art, the team drew inspiration from 80s European graphic novels, many of which dealt with oversaturated color schemes and dramatic cinematic lighting. They were dead set on delivering movie quality graphics and wanted to push the PlayStation to its limits to show players the absolute highest level of quality in a PlayStation title. To nail the look and feel of the game, they spent a lot of time in pre-production first, far longer than what was typical, and went through lots of iteration. Once they'd finalized the look of a particular character, they'd then proceed to build a sculpture of them. The reason for doing this was due to the relatively primitive CG tools available to them at the time. By creating actual sculptures, they were able to properly lay out things, like where the bones were, that the muscles were in the right place, etc. Once the sculpture was made, they could then digitize it by taking an electronic pen and carefully going around the sculpture to get the exact shape into the computer. They would then layer on the skeletal system and apply the textures, which resulted in something far more true to life than anything built on the computer from scratch. With this approach, they knew how far the arms could travel, that they couldn't bend in certain directions, etc. With these constraints in place, it was then ready to be animated. They went through the same process when creating the game's environments, starting on paper and then fleshing them out with lots of iteration. They designed the architecture and all of the elements that were going to be in the game, making sure that they worked on paper first before building them in the computer, because once it was in the computer, it started getting much more expensive and there was less flexibility to make changes. A standout feature of Abe's Odyssey was its Qualma system, where the actions of a player determined the outcome of the game, resulting in either a good or bad ending, depending on how many Badokans you saved or killed, respectively. There was a lot of opposition internally about Abe getting chopped up in the bad ending, as some members of the team didn't want players going through the entire game, only to be told that the reward for doing so was that they'd killed Abe. Lanning, however, felt that it was perfectly reasonable. It's how they won. They were a jerk, so they deserved to have that happen. The team thought that was ridiculous, and believed players would hate it. Another notable feature was their artificial intelligence routine, Aware Life Forms in Virtual Entertainment, or Alive, that cleverly controlled the actions of the creatures according to the situation they were faced with. The purpose of this was to try and make the characters in the game behave in a way that felt lifelike. By doing so, they hoped to increase the possibility of engaging players emotionally. Abe's Odyssey wasn't a game that really demanded fine motor controls or dexterity as the game progressed. Instead, it was a game that required players to use their heads. They wanted it to be a game for adults that children would also love, and for it to appeal to a larger demographic than 12-year-old boys. Something McKenna found most rewarding was the fact that people could get just as much enjoyment from watching someone play the game as they did playing it themselves. Their efforts to make Abe's Odyssey as lifelike as possible backfired somewhat when it came to the game's difficulty. They didn't want any on-screen meters keeping track of things like the player's health, which meant one hit killed you. They felt that a one-hit kill was more believable than a guy being repeatedly shot, but in doing so, they ended up creating a game that was much harder than they intended. Oddworld Abe's Odyssey launched on the 19th September 1997 on Odd Friday for the PlayStation and shortly thereafter for PC. The game received critical acclaim, with reviewers praising its tight 2D platforming, perfectly balanced action and puzzle elements, beautiful graphics and animations that were unlike anything seen before, and imaginative AI and visual designs that went a long way towards making you feel as though you were interacting with an actual world and its inhabitants. The game was also criticised for its extremely high difficulty, with the trial and error level design, sensitive controls, and occasional slowdown further exacerbating the issue. Prior to Abe Odyssey's launch, GT Interactive announced it was spending $10 million on marketing the game, including advertising spots on the television and print magazines, as well as a promotional campaign on the internet. It was the most expensive marketing campaign launched by GT Interactive at the time. Following the game's release, the team received more fan mail from girls and adults than anyone could have ever imagined, as the game was able to reach a much wider audience than most other titles. Still, despite their success, the game was murder on the team, and the initial release was disastrous for the company. After sending off what they thought was the final gold disc for manufacturing, they discovered a critical crash bug that was repeatable throughout the entire game. Immediately, they got on the phone to stop the disc from being sent to manufacturing. After receiving word that the disc had been stopped, they proceeded to stay up all night fixing the bug and mastering a new disc, a process that took several hours, to be shipped by FedEx to GT Interactive's offices first thing in the morning, only to discover that the sales team had approved the previous disc without checking with them first. This meant that those unlucky enough to own the first print of the game would be left disappointed and frustrated by a buggy build that never should have reached store shelves. To further compound the issue, retailer GameStop had created an unofficial hint guide for the game in the US. When the team finished Abe's Odyssey, they went back through it and embedded secrets throughout the game for players to discover. These secret areas would be where you'd find almost half of all the Madokins you're tasked to save, and would be some of the most brutal levels in the game. The team made sure to almost always include some sort of audio or visual clue to indicate to the player that a secret area was nearby, but they knew most players wouldn't be able to discover all of them on their first playthrough, or at least that was the intention. The staff putting together the hint guide decided that one of the first things they'd show was how to enter the secret area in the first level, possibly the worst thing you could have told a new player to do. So straight away, people were finding the game too difficult and would quit playing. However, in spite of these setbacks, the game was a commercial success, going on to win more than 40 major industry awards and selling over a million copies worldwide by January 1998, with it later going on to sell 3.5 million copies worldwide in total. A month after its release, Abe's Odyssey was published by SoftBank in Japan under the name Abe-a-Go-Go. Outside of being localized into Japanese, the game featured two significant differences from its American and European counterparts. The first was the image of the Madokin Pop, featured in the opening cinematic. In the original, the game featured a realistic-looking severed head, shoved onto a stick, dripping blood. About a week before they were set to unveil the game to the press, there was a gruesome murder in Japan that shocked the nation. A Japanese student had cut off the head of one of his peers, and hung it in front of the school gate. The team was given a heads up, and told that it'd probably be a good idea to change the design, which they agreed to without question. The newer design brought the Madokin Pops more in line with the other products displayed in the opening cinematic, featuring that particular gloss of marketing that hid the true horror of what the Gluckens were actually doing, which Lanning liked. The second significant change was to Abe's four-fingered design. Historically, Japan had a subclass of meatpacking workers that were typically looked down upon in their society. The blatant displaying of a four-fingered hand gesture, intentionally directed at another, came to be an insult. The four-finger connection with the meatpacking class was due to work-related accidents, but was so frequent that it came to symbolically represent the subclass. This was a part of Japanese history that some groups within Japan wanted to see forgotten. Therefore, if you intended to publish four-fingered characters in Japan, you were likely to end up in legal battles with this loud and forceful pressure group. However, Lanning noticed that Mickey Mouse, with his four-fingered design, was able to live in Japan without alteration. It turned out this pressure group was more than happy to look the other way in exchange for compensation. In other words, if you paid up, then it was fine, but if you didn't, then it was a horrible insult to Japanese culture. Being Oddworld, the team felt this was the perfect addition to Abe's story. They thought it was ironically perfect that he was being discriminated against for being who he was, so they chopped off one of his fingers so that the Japanese wouldn't get offended or paid. In December 1997, production began on Abe Gets Boned and Brewed, which was the working title for Abe's Exodus. Unlike its predecessor, the game wouldn't be part of the Oddworld Quintology. Instead, it was a bonus title that built upon the engine and assets of the first game to tell a bigger story for Abe and explore new areas of Oddworld. The positive reception of Abe's Odyssey created a lot of buzz within the team, and they couldn't wait to unveil more about Oddworld and its inhabitants. They wanted to reveal more glimpses of how the Modokans lived in the past and where they would go in the future. One goal was to show how the Modokan culture had degraded as a result of exploitation and Glukan greed, as well as feature more of the Glukan corporate structure and the systems supporting those structures. However, this excitement was quickly dampened when GT Interactive gave the team an impossible deadline. They wanted it ready in time for Christmas 98, which meant they had roughly 9 months to make the game. Lanning had naively believed that the success of Abe's Odyssey would give the team a little leeway, so that they could take their time developing a new engine and the next game in the Quintology. What he failed to realise was the exact opposite was going to happen. The situation was made worse by Lanning's insistence that a sequel needed to be twice as big, as this was very much the common belief of the era. This meant more cinematics, more levels, and more Modokans to save, all of which had to be built in a third of the time, and would end up needing to ship on two discs instead of one due to the sheer amount of content. They knew that they didn't have enough time to create the second entry in the Quintology, so instead, they decided to tell more of the story they originally thought they were going to tell in Abe's Odyssey. Even so, the story ended up being watered down in an effort to ensure they could ship the game before Christmas. With a strict deadline to meet, McKenna was adamant about providing a healthy work environment. If people came into the office with junk food, she'd confiscate it and throw it away. She was a firm believer that healthy workers were productive workers, and so she fronted the money to buy everyone vitamins each week, provided fresh fruit baskets, and tried creating an environment that employees felt good about and safe to work at. By doing this, she hoped to invigorate the team, as their passion would be reflected in the final product. The story picked up right where Abe's Odyssey left off, with Abe having successfully shut down Rupture Farms after rescuing all 99 enslaved Modokans. In doing so, he unknowingly created an ingredient shortage for another Glukan franchise, Soulstorm Brewery. A brew made from bones and Modokan tears. By shutting down Rupture Farms, Abe stopped the flow of bones to Soulstorm Brewery, but business must go on, so the Glukans start mining an ancient Modokan burial ground instead. This disturbs the resting place of a trio of Modokan spirits, known as the Free Weirdos, who visit Abe in order to ask for his help. The Glukans are so greedy that the Modokans are forced to work with their eyes stitched shut, for fear that productivity would suffer if they knew they had been exploiting their own burial grounds. This concept was spurred from real-world historical accounts of using native people, whether willfully or unwittingly, to undermine and destroy the record and culture of their way of life. Historically, addiction has been one of many tools used in an attempt to suppress cultures, which made it an ideal concept for story and design development. Lanning's father was a reformed alcoholic, so he'd attend Alcoholics Anonymous with him on the weekends whenever he went to see him. He had no idea the value that experience would have on his life, and so in addition to its messages on environmentalism, mysticism, and anti-commercialism that appeared in the first game, Abe's Exodus also paid homage to the 12-step program. Early design influences for Necrom, the Modokan burial grounds, were Mayan architecture and some of the structures from the Paris catacombs. Rock spires reminiscent of bone, or worm-eaten wood, were later added, while Fico Depot was reminiscent of the vast ornate train depots of the turn of the century, fused with Oddworldian flair. Blinded Madocans were given paler skin than Abe, to further accentuate their poor working conditions and health. The Mudimo and Modanchi vaults were created as a direct result of the game's 9-month production cycle. They didn't exist in the original plan, but it made sense to reuse the Paramites and Scrabs from the first game that had already been developed. Abe's Exodus was largely built off the back of its predecessor, with many of the same gameplay mechanics and features carrying over. However, the team did make a number of notable changes. Many reviewers and players had complained about the first game's save and checkpoint system, so the team addressed this by implementing a quick save feature that would save a game's progress to RAM, so that players wouldn't have to wait for the memory card to load and write data. Then, when Abe died, the player would be instantly returned to the place they last quicksaved. The team also improved the game's regular saving too, by having it save everything exactly in the state it was in when you chose to save, which was pretty much how PC game saves worked. When Abe's Odyssey released, the team watched internet chat rooms and forums very closely and noticed that a number of people were having difficulty and getting frustrated with the game because they needed to die in order to figure out how to solve particular puzzles. The team knew you needed to die to learn solutions, and it was for that reason that they gave players infinite lives, but while testing amongst their small numbers, they hadn't foreseen this as being much of an issue. It was only after hundreds of thousands of people started playing it that they became aware of the inherent weakness of the game. To rectify this, they tried to make virtually every puzzle into one that could be studied visually first. It was difficult to get the tuning right, with the limitations they had at the time, but by doing this, they could create a game that was far less frustrating for players, and hopefully make something that more people would enjoy. Early in production, the designers discovered that shadows cast across a cylinder created dynamic curves, which were a great contrast against the abundance of linear platform elements that Abe had to interact with. The temple inside Necrom is an example of the practical need for dynamic lighting in all backgrounds. In Abe's Odyssey, game screens were made by composing them in a 3D tool and then rendering them out. The game featured around 450 backgrounds, while Abe's Exodus had over 1,000, with no two being alike. With so many to make, and such a tight deadline to meet, composing all of the environments in 3D simply wouldn't allow enough flexibility, time-wise or design-wise. To address this, they created a virtual prop house, rendering out key mid-ground and foreground elements in different rotations and quadrants of the screen, and then digitized them using Photoshop. This virtual prop house allowed them to move platforms, doors, traps, or shadow areas, and meet game design expectations, without a massive cost to the art team if puzzle revisions were needed. The effect was remarkably convincing, and worked quite well. The job of creating these 1,000-plus backgrounds fell on a team of 5 digital paint artists, who were guided by an Oddworld signature, a series of 6 artistic commandments created by Lanning and production designer Fazard Farahramayan. These were: be realistic, have solidity, be original, be cool, evoke emotions, and look alive. Working from blueprints provided by the game designers, and with an overall vision supplied by the art directors, the paint artists created each unique game screen by first choosing a foundation of pre-rendered 3D images to dress the set. Each 3D object was painstakingly built to exact specifications by the team's CG department, and then networked into the virtual prop house for the paint artists to use. The first phase was to assemble and place the fundamental structures that the characters interacted with, whilst maintaining the signature architecture of that particular level, including the overall lighting design. The second phase involved embellishing the scene with finer detail, enhancing the mood, and creating environmental depth with a vista. This second refinement phase saw game screens go through dozens of painstaking revisions, which included changes introduced by the evolving game design. For example, the Fico Depot main lobby was overhauled late in the design process. It required building a dozen or so new game screens from scratch and throwing out the old ones, a difficult thing to do for proud artists. Each of these 1,000-plus backgrounds took about 6 to 8 hours to complete. Towards the end of the game's development, they were doing roughly 4 a day, working 16-hour days, 7 days a week. It was hell. While many of the game's mechanics were similar to how they were in Abe's Odyssey, the team also added new powers, game speak options, characters, and abilities. they greatly expanded possession by allowing players to possess almost everything in the game, including Sligs, Paramites, Scrabs, Gluckens, and even Abe's Flatulence, which created all sorts of funny new interactions. All of the new characters you could possess also came with their own game speak as well, and a new command was added to allow Abe to have all of the Madokans on screen follow him at once, instead of one at a time, like in the first game. This created new gameplay opportunities by having the Madokans solve a wider variety of puzzles. The number of Madokans Abe had to rescue increased from 99 to 300, and was once again accompanied by a good or bad ending, depending on how many Madokans you managed to save. The Madokans were also given different emotional states and characteristics, such as being angry, wired, depressed, sick, or blind, with new game speak options being added to help Abe deal with them. For example, angry Madokans will smack other nearby Madokans, operate traps, and refuse to follow Abe until he tells them he's sorry. Depressed Madokans will similarly not follow Abe's orders, but will also commit suicide if the player hits them, or they witness another one of their fellow Madokans being killed, while blinded Madokans are unable to follow Abe like regular Madokans can, requiring the player to use well-timed gamespeak commands to prevent them from wandering into hazards. These emotions helped to give the Madokans more personality and made them more endearing, whilst also being funnier to watch and interact with. The increased presence of the Gluckens necessitated Abe to make greater use of the Schreikle, a powerful transformation that players first earned in Abe's Odyssey after completing the Scrabania and Paramonia trials. They needed a super weapon that would be synergistic with Abe's training and heritage, and with it being capable of decimating an entire room full of enemies, the Schreikle fit the bill perfectly. Its one-time use before needing to be recharged also ensured it couldn't be abused. Another new addition was a character named Alf, who was one of the five Madokans that accompanied Abe to Necrom, and was also seen at the end of the game running a Soulstorm Brew rehabilitation clinic called Alf's Rehab and Tea. The character was named after a real-life person called Alfred Gamble, a 72-year-old fan who swears Abe's Odyssey saved his life. Gamble was a British World War II veteran who, after surviving the war, became a lorry driver for a few years and then eventually retired. His wife became afflicted with a debilitating illness, and he spent the remaining years of her life nurturing her. When she passed away, Gamble lost all sense of hope. He became cynical, drank excessive amounts of alcohol, disengaged from his grandkids, and felt as though he had nothing left to live for. He had a service pistol, but when he tried to take his life, he couldn't work up the courage to pull the trigger. He was mad at himself for being so weak, and being unable to do what he needed to. He later figured that perhaps what was keeping him bound to this world was the money he still had left in his bank account. So he went to a store with the intention of spending what little money he had left on whatever he could find. It's here where he spotted a PlayStation and a copy of Abe's Odyssey. Abe's dopey-looking expression on the box art made Gamble feel as though he could relate to this sad, pathetic little guy, and so he bought it and took it home with him. In an effort to exhaust his resistance to committing suicide, he decided to start playing the game, but what he didn't expect was for the game to make him laugh. For the first time in ages, he was laughing. He started playing the game every day, and started laughing more. He then reached out to his grandkids, and asked them if they'd ever heard of this game. Eventually, he even reached out to Oddworld inhabitants. He wrote a multi-page letter where he went into great detail about his life, how he'd lost his beloved wife, and how he wanted to end it all before he found their game. After reading his letters, the team broke down into tears. They kept an album of all of the letters and photos he'd sent them for anybody within the studio to view. His story was so moving and inspiring to the team that they had to honor him in some way, and that's when Alf was born. After a grueling 9 months, Oddworld Abe's Exodus released in time for Christmas 1998. But much like Abe's Odyssey before it, things weren't entirely smooth sailing. The game suffered from a disastrous distribution at launch. As the commercials were running, thousands of copies of the game had been lost in a warehouse somewhere in New Jersey following an acquisition. They only found out about this because of other developers who were in the same boat. As Lanning received calls from people congratulating him for the game being sold out, the reality was there wasn't any games on store shelves to sell. To make matters worse, the sales team at GT Interactive weren't acknowledging this. They saw the poor sales numbers and just assumed that the game wasn't as popular as its predecessor. In response to hearing this, Lanning had an employee phone every retailer in the US for a straight week to find out how many games were on the shelf. every major city, every major outlet, they tracked the number, and when all was said and done, there were about 150 games total that were still on the shelf. Retrieving those lost games wasn't a simple matter either, as the warehouse in question didn't have its inventory properly managed. You couldn't even have people walking around reading boxes, because it was all just barcodes. As a result of this, Abe's Exodus never fully made it into the US retail space, which devastated the team. Prior to its release, as the game was drawing to a close, plans came together for an Abe's Exodus movie to be submitted for an Oscar consideration to the Academy of Motion Pictures Arts and Sciences under the Animated Short category, with it enjoying a theatrical release in Los Angeles in late October 1998. Oddworld was honored to be the first video game company to enter the prestigious category, though it ultimately didn't receive a nomination. With Abe's Exodus behind them, the team set out to create the second game in the Oddworld quintology, Munch's Odyssey. The story of Munch had already been in development prior to the founding of Oddworld Inhabitants, with conceptual game design beginning in 1997. However, they didn't start on production design, prototyping, art and coding until late 1998. The concept for the game's story was based on the pharmaceutical industry and animal testing in multi-billion dollar corporations, with Munch being an animal testing victim who would team up with Abe to fight the forces of consumerism. Abe's mother was also intended to make an appearance in the story, but she didn't make the cut. GameSpeak was to be expanded to allow players to relocate characters, put them to work, have them gather resources, defend areas, or use them as weapons, with Lanning describing it at the time as Age of Empires being controlled by Mario. They were moving from half NTSC resolution to full DVD quality at 30 frames per second, so they wanted to up the bar of quality from their previous efforts to match this technological leap forward. They also wanted greater clarity in their animations and have lip syncing be much tighter. Another goal they had was for players to have greater responsibility over the environment, with simulated landscape elements such as fertile terrain which hadn't been polluted. If the land was barren of water or trees, then the life forms that inhabited that region would fall on hard times and reproduce less often. The player's actions, or lack thereof, would influence the state of the landscape and, as a result, influence the availability of resources and behaviour of the land's inhabitants, with a day and night cycle further playing into this by having nocturnal creatures come out to hunt at night but sleep in caves during the day, and factories being in full production during daylight hours but wind down in the evening. The player could then decide to wait out circumstances, such as attempting infiltration at night instead of during the day. Different strategies would emerge as a result, and there would be situations that called upon players to nurture the environment to bring forth what they needed. Storm circles were one example of environmental manipulation. When enough Madokans chant, lightning bursts out, changing the environment in ways that benefit the native forces, such as altering the water level of a particular area. Storm circles were originally intended to have multiple purposes, such as becoming a massive surge weapon, a lightning strike that would arc from the circle to take out industrial facilities miles away. Munch's Odyssey was to be less puzzle-oriented and game-like, and instead focus more on world simulation and the behaviours of the characters and ecosystems to achieve more living impressions. Previous Oddworld titles had been more difficult than they would have liked, and they found the controller schemes to be too complex, so with Munch's Odyssey, the team strived for a balance that increased immersion and fun factor whilst also reducing player frustration. They intended to add multiple levels of difficulty, have the characters move around more smoothly and feel more intuitive to control, and ensure players wouldn't be left stranded or get stuck because they didn't have the twitch ability for some particular challenge. The addition of full analog control made things simpler, while still giving players access to more abilities, such as Abe being able to pick up and throw objects and people. They also wanted to remove instances of one-hit deaths, in exchange for prolonged challenges where you'd carefully navigate hostile areas, be chased by enemies, etc. But as the design of the game grew, and technical and time restrictions started to emerge, it became clear to the team that they wouldn't be able to implement all of their ideas. The final version of Munch's Odyssey fell short of their original vision, with Lanning being particularly dissatisfied with how the story changed over the course of development, along with the engineering challenges that arose from transitioning to new hardware, which further impacted the game's design. The onset of 128-bit next-gen consoles signified the end of 2D games, so the team had no choice but to switch to real-time 3D. This meant they needed to throw out all of their old tools and engine and start again from scratch. In 1998, just as production of Munch's Odyssey began, they licensed the Unreal Engine in an attempt to learn from it. Even if they didn't end up using it, they could still get an idea of what was truly possible with the technology. Two of the biggest shortcomings in 3D games at the time were the camera systems and the character's sense of truly being aware in the world. To remedy this, they aimed to fix the orientation and motion sickness problems with their camera system, whilst also making it feel more cinematic in its delivery, without compromising playability. To tackle the character awareness problem, they created a system that was designed to help the game's inhabitants identify where they were in the environment, and to also recognize what items of interest might be nearby. They wanted actions such as picking up an item to feel as fluid and natural as they did in 2D, but still look convincing in a 3D environment. Their artificial intelligence routine, Alive, also received an update from Much's Odyssey. This second generation technology, appropriately called Alive 2, allowed for an even more convincing sense of life for their characters and simulations. The character of Munch was inspired by creatures that had lost the extinction battle to humanity's gluttonous appetite, as well as the hundreds of millions of creatures subjected to laboratory testing every day. Physically, they wanted a body or form that was completely different from the usual biped characters, as this would give them the freedom to explore new types of basic control mechanics. They first started designing Munch in 1996, using photos and research of animal testing kept on hand in the Oddworld reference library to help influence his appearance. These designs started off as literal rabbits, with all sorts of surgical grafts, pins, and amputations. But over time, the designs evolved to be less like abused rabbits, and more like similar helpless creatures caught in the same predicament. They explored virtually every permutation, from hundreds of legs to none at all, creatures with arms and ones without, flying, floating, gas-propelled, landlocked, amphibian, carnivorous, fat, thin, tall, etc. Then every variation of suitable animal was considered, including apes, mice, cats, dogs, birds, reptiles, dinosaurs, sharks, alligators, and even completely alien creatures. One design had Munch depicted as a centipede, with a giant translucent head that he could inflate, float upwards, and propel himself by expelling bursts of gas, like a balloon with a hole in it. After about 2 years of designing, certain elements kept coming to the forefront, such as a big gaping mouth full of teeth, influenced by his name, big eyes for classic childlike facial proportions and legibility on screen, two arms and one leg so that there was one less limb to worry about, and a more fluid form that would allow for locomotion in water. Inspired by photos of experimental cats and monkeys with their brains exposed, they fitted Munch with a head port that allowed him to find other critters and bring them back to the Vikers for experimentation. Munch's purplish skin and eyes were meant to make him appear cuter in a fish tank kind of way, with subtle amphibious patterns to define him as the fish out of water that he really was. It took a long time, and hundreds of drawings to get the final look of Munch right, even though he was so simple, because they needed to have this sad quality about him whilst also making him funny. A difficult task, given that he was a victim of such tragic circumstances. The inspiration for Munch's wheelchair came about after the team saw an online discussion on how there had never been a video game with a wheelchair in it before. They thought that using a wheelchair as a power-up for a character that was less agile on land was a great idea, though they originally intended Munch to be wheelchair-bound for a good portion of the story, with A being the one pushing him around. This would have led to some resentment, as Munch didn't appreciate being forced to go wherever Abe wanted. However, in the final version, Munch could use his wheelchair on his own, without Abe's assistance. Munch was also initially going to have a Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde quality about him. If angered, his emotional state would have triggered a metamorphosis into this huge and gruesome Hyde-like alter ego called Roid. This would have been similar to the Hulk, in that he would gain incredible strength for a limited time. Abe could slap Munch to anger him, which would provoke the steroids that had been tested on him to turn him into a bulky maniacal killer. But the idea was too ambitious, and it wasn't long before the team realized they were in too deep. They didn't have the resources at the time to implement the idea as it was originally conceived. The rest of the production was a process that could be referred to as reactionary design. It's what happens when an idea isn't able to manifest properly, but production is already underway, and the only solution left is to figure out how to get something viable completed. Munch's Odyssey saw the return of many familiar Oddworld species, whilst also introducing several new ones, such as the Vikers, a race of wrinkly-skinned tripeds that possessed extensive knowledge of medicine and surgery, as they went to great lengths to keep their bodies functioning long past their natural lifespan. Their enormous heads and insect-like arms were an outgrowth of the archetypal grey aliens from classic abduction accounts. While they appeared to be old men, their high nasally voices and effeminate gestures made them more androgynous. They were the embodiment of the lecherous doctor and the abusive nurse in one body. Beyond being merely invasive and unsanitary, the design of the Vikers' tools were inspired by aquatic creatures that live in the most hostile ocean habitats. From the bioluminescent hunters of the deep, to armored hermit crabs that emerge from their shells in a flash to strike their prey, Vikers' surgical design was overtly predatory. The Vikers' architecture was a collision of 19th century Gothic science with 21st century corporate pharmaceutical design. Fuzzles were another new species introduced in Munch's Odyssey, and consisted of nothing more than a round blob covered in thick brown fur, with two bulging eyes and a large mouth full of razor-sharp teeth. The designers had a very short amount of time to complete the different iterations of Fuzzles, which might explain why they were so simplistic, but they had a lot of freedom with their designs, and were some of the most fun to create. The Almighty Raisin was a wise, long-lived seed-like creature that evolved from an elder tree in the northern parts of Mudos. The Madokans held him to a near-religious level due to his vast knowledge and wisdom, with them often going to him to seek guidance or advice. In order to fuse a sense of wisdom into the Raisin's design, they gave him a beard like an old Chinese medicine man, and face paint of an ages-old shaman. For the Raisin's cave, the team drew inspiration from places like the caves in Lascaux, France, that are covered in ancient paintings. There were also a number of new species that ended up being cut from the game. Some of these were the Sea Rex, a giant sea creature that originally appeared in the opening cinematic, but was cut due to its massive size. Skeeters, which were huge mosquito-like creatures that attached themselves to the heads of their victims. And the Chronicler, which acted as both a lawyer and accountant. The Chronicler was originally going to have a big lawyer role in the story, but ended up being cut from the script, and subsequently never appeared in the game. Elam was also planned to make a return, after being absent from Abe's Exodus, but also didn't make the cut. Alongside a game show called Name That Trauma, where Madokans were tortured behind curtains, requiring the player to guess the means of torture being used. As the game design evolved, it became apparent that different classes of Madokans were needed. In order to distinguish them, Lanning suggested having Madokans grow feathers as they become more spiritual, like headdresses used in ancient cultures to represent status. A Madokan who was a slave to industry wouldn't have any, whereas a powerful shaman, who was the spiritual apex of Madokan culture, would have a fully feathered decorative headdress. Though, in the case of the shaman, they weren't able to create an elaborate headdress for technical reasons, so they needed to tone it down a bit. Along with the headdress, warrior and shaman bodies were painted in various colours to give them a tribal and distinctive feel. As for the Madokan architecture, they based the designs and building materials on Native American architecture with an odd-world twist. Simple but exaggerated shapes, with details of wood and stonework held together with dried animal skins, became the motif of these structures. They needed to be unique and interesting, but also couldn't be very complex, because they had to be built as in-game assets. The industrial buildings, on the other hand, were the polar opposite. These facilities were based on the huge brooding structures built during early industrialization. This gave the team some design cues to follow, such as massive smokestacks, lots of small windows, and various scaffolding. They then took it a step further by building faces into the buildings to make them appear more oppressive and iconic. A handful of industrial vehicles were also cut from the game, including the Harvester, a tree eater that would slowly creep into Madokan habitats, mulching any plant life in its path, a slig tank, and a controllable dual slig aircraft. With their previous titles finding enormous success on the original PlayStation, it only made sense for Munch's Odyssey to target the PlayStation 2. With the increased power of the PS2, they could have more on-screen characters, more elaborate lifelike behaviours, and larger worlds with more AI running underneath everything. However, it didn't take long before their initial excitement for the console started to sour. Most of the game had been built on PC before they'd received any PS2 dev kits, but once they arrived, they soon realised just how difficult the console was to work with. This was a common complaint from developers at the time. Despite being a capable machine, there were a number of low-level problems that required them to spend a lot of time on things that they didn't even have to think about on PC. Anti-aliasing was something the team had particular issues with, and they invested a considerable amount of time and money in an effort to improve the game's image quality. Munch's Odyssey was originally intended to release on the PS2 in June 2001, but on the 17th of October 2000, just 9 days before the PS2's North American launch, Oddworld Inhabitants signed a deal with Microsoft to be an exclusive launch title for the Xbox instead. This infuriated their fans, and the team received more hate mail than anyone could have possibly imagined. However, this decision was more of an emergency measure for Oddworld. Their publisher at the time, GT Interactive, had recently been acquired by Infogrames, and they heard through the grapevine that they were cutting every budget that was more than $3 million. Munch's Odyssey was projected to be around $10 million, which meant they needed to find a new publisher, as the writing was on the wall. The only company that was really behind them at the time, and also had the money to keep them going, was Microsoft, so the team had little choice but to sign up with them. Being a launch title for a new console meant they had no wiggle room on deadlines, resulting in content being trimmed or cut from the game to ensure it remained on schedule. At the time, the game to beat was Super Mario, so Microsoft wanted Munch to be their answer to Nintendo's mascot. As such, they proposed the rather unimaginative title, Abe and Munch's Fun Adventures, which Oddworld promptly rejected. Munch's cinematics also caused a bit of friction between the two companies. Oddworld Inhabitants had always strived for excellence with their cinematics, and it was a large part of what made Oddworld games so distinct from others in the industry. So when somebody at Microsoft showed them one of their cinematics, after being compressed by Bing Video, Lanning was not impressed. Video game cinematics were, at the time, seen as fairly unimportant, so the executive producers at Microsoft had a hard time understanding why Oddworld was so upset. The Xbox shipped with a DVD player, but the Bing Video compression made the cinematics look like low bitrate web videos. It wasn't really a problem with Bing Video itself though, it was just that nobody knew how to dial it in properly. The move to Xbox wasn't all bad though, as there were a number of benefits. They could run many more characters on screen at a time, with higher polygon counts, and much larger environments, with true dynamic lighting, which made a significant difference to the game's visual makeup. There were also things like bump mapping, reflection mapping, and other technological capabilities afforded to them thanks to DirectX 8. Additional audio memory and faster disk access also allowed them to hold more words and animations. It took a tremendous amount of work, but Munch's Odyssey was finished in time for its 15th of November 2001 launch, alongside the North American release of the Xbox. The game received fairly positive reviews from critics, but several outlets remarked on how it didn't feel as nearly as polished as their previous titles. This wasn't news to the team, as they had to make substantial cuts and changes due to technical and time constraints, preventing Munch's Odyssey from truly living up to everyone's expectations. Lanning later lamented on his overly ambitious design for the game, and how his lack of discipline resulted in him setting unrealistic goals for the team. It was the project that he was the least satisfied with. In typical Oddworld fashion, the game's release went less than smoothly than they'd hoped. The game's cinematics featured newsreels, which referred to Abe and Munch as terrorists. Then 9/11 happened, prompting the team to go back and call them fugitives instead, as calling them terrorists, in light of recent events, would have been seen as tasteless. But perhaps their biggest hurdle was something nobody foresaw, the explosive popularity of Halo, which also launched alongside the Xbox. Microsoft originally wanted Munch's Odyssey to help sell the Xbox as a casual, family-friendly console, but once they saw how successful Halo was, priorities shifted, and suddenly the Xbox was being marketed as a device for hardcore gamers. Halo's success completely overshadowed Munch's Odyssey, to the point where the team needed to reevaluate their future projects. Originally, they had planned to start work on Munch's Exodus, a bonus game similar to that of Abe's Exodus, following the release of the game, with work on the game's script having already begun. However, with the lukewarm reception to Munch's Odyssey, and Halo's dominance in the market, they decided to change course, meaning Munch's Exodus never saw the light of day. The team had also been developing a multiplayer RTS game called Hand of Art, which would have used the same technology as Munch's Odyssey, with added multiplayer functionality. Both games started development in 1998, with the original goal being to release Hand of Art 6 to 9 months after the release of Munch's Odyssey. However, the infrastructure for online consoles was rather murky at the time, so it made more sense to focus on Munch's Odyssey and Munch's Exodus instead. Rather than having hundreds of units being controlled by a mouse, Hand of Art would have instead had players directing creatures using central characters via GameSpeak. The game would have broken away from the typical RTS model of having two opposing sides ravaging the landscape in order to build military complexes in an attempt to declare victory over the other. In this scenario, the environment was always the loser. The game would have instead featured an industrial class that followed the prevailing RTS paradigm, as well as a competing indigenous class that gained its power from nurturing the environment's growth, then harnessing its life force as a means to power an offense and defense system, with players choosing to play as either a Gluckan executive or Madokan tribal chief, respectively. The game had been designed and documented, with some preliminary development on assets, but the market was changing rapidly. The success of Warcraft 2, which was a key inspiration for the team, created a flurry of subpar products that convinced many publishers that the RTS market was dead. Lanning remembered exactly the moment when he realized that they might be headed for trouble, and it wasn't an internal production issue. It was the men's room at LAX Airport, where standing next to him at the sink was Activision CEO Bobby Kotick. They started discussing what they were working on, and that's when Lanning mentioned that they were trying their hand at an Oddworld RTS game. Kotick told Lanning not to bother, as the RTS market wasn't performing well. This was also around the time that GT Interactive had been acquired by Infograms, who were being very content risk averse, so the team decided to put Hand of Odd on hold and wait for a more promising publishing climate. The work they did on Hand of Odd wasn't a complete waste, however, as it gave the team the opportunity to flesh out more of the Oddworld universe. Originally starting out as an early Munch's Exodus project, Oddworld Stranger's Wrath, known simply as Oddworld Stranger at the time, was more of a departure from what had come before, with it ditching its puzzle platforming mechanics and its meek protagonists, Abe and Munch, for something that was more in line with what audiences at the time wanted to see, while still presenting a story and landscape that was inescapably Oddworld. But even though the team had succumbed to making a shooter, they refused to do it in the same way everyone else was doing it. Stranger's Wrath was heavily inspired by Sergio Leone and his spaghetti western films, A Fistful of Dollars, For a Few Dollars More, and The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, with the game's concept revolving around IMF-backed theft of indigenous water supplies in their support for truly awful corporations like Monsanto. Lanning believed that clean water and water rights were something that would be at the forefront of global politics and conflict as humanity entered the next century. More than ever, they wanted the game setting to convey the subtext of the story. The arid landscapes were washed in a dusty amber glow, with gnarled roots twisted in arthritic forms and covered with thorny blades of grass. The look of each region pertained more to the backstory of the characters who lived there than anything else. These characters were loosely based on real-world settlers, natives, and industrial forces, so the architecture of their homes and environment followed suit. The Clackers could be compared to the settlers of the Gold Rush era, so the towns they inhabited were given an Old West look to them, while the small villages the Grubs inhabited were loosely based on Native American dwellings. The look of the game was determined very early on during the concept phase, with everything being pretty much locked in within the first 4 to 6 months. The team had really come together by this point, so they were in a good position to make the game, and it was also the one they had the most fun with. By doing something outside of the Quintology, it gave them the opportunity to expand the landscape of Oddworld, whilst also giving them the freedom to focus on some new playstyles. In order to bring something fresh and exciting to the shooter genre, there were three major elements they insisted upon. First was a great shooting mechanic, second was a character with some serious issues, and third was a story that was fully integrated with the gameplay. Rather than rely on familiar characters, the team focused on creating entirely new ones so that they had more room and flexibility with the story and design. Unlike Munch's Odyssey, which underwent numerous changes throughout development due to time and technical constraints, the ideas for Stranger's Wrath remained largely unaltered from concept to finish. While looking at other shooters, Halo in particular, they realized that you could easily, and more efficiently, ramp up the challenge value of a shooter than you could with a puzzle game. Players would happily shoot things all day long, but nobody wanted to do the same puzzle twice. Another game they were playing a lot of was Driver. Lanning loved driving around and ramming into stuff, with the physics sending objects flying. They wanted to do something similar for Stranger's Wrath, which became the basis for Stranger's vehicle-like speed while in third person. They were creating a third-person action game with melee combat, a high-speed driver-inspired game where you could ram into stuff, and a first-person shooter all in one. Breaking down the barrier between first-person shooting and third-person adventuring took a lot of work to pull off, because they wanted to make sure there were sufficient tactical reasons for players to care about both. To spearhead this new adventure, the team needed a new character for players to take control of. Abe and Munch were scrawny weaklings that fought oppression through their innocence and strength of will. In the case of Stranger, the team decided to flip this on its head, to create a character that was physically very strong, but emotionally weak. Someone who wanted to be anyone other than himself, and in the process of finding his true self, he'd realized that he's become something far greater than he ever could have imagined. A character of strength and action that would discover his ability to care rather than the other way around. For the most part, Stranger's appearance was defined by his lifestyle and surroundings, but artistic elements like the symbolic designs on his poncho were faded signs of his origins, while the crossbow was a reflection of his personality traits as a lone bounty hunter. The team chose the crossbow primarily for its silent firing, which allowed them to incorporate stealth gameplay elements. They also created an entirely new outlaw class, which was separate from the industrialists, natives, and wildlife classes of previous Oddworld games. They were the ragtag remnants of species that once had some level of significance, but were now renegades that banded together, kind of like Alibaba and the 40 Thieves, or bounty hunters in America, guys making money any way they can. Stranger was such a dramatic departure from Abe and Munch that they needed a new approach to the way the story cinematics were told. While previous Oddworld stories had been communicated through poetic narration and dialogue, Stranger's tale would reflect his character by being light on talk and heavy on kinetic action. The characters in their prior games were often defined by their affiliation with the oppressive industrial forces or the abused native ones. Outlaws, meanwhile, went beyond these classifications to represent more self-centered elements that were better suited to the nature of a frontier, which created a new perspective to the storytelling. These cinematics were created by only a handful of people, meaning a great deal of responsibility was placed upon each artist's shoulders to innovate on new techniques, while remaining efficient. As the production went on, the CG team got smaller, resulting in the old processes and pipeline being thrown out, and a new system based more on independence organically emerged. The weight of responsibility forced each member of the team to learn at a much faster rate than ever before. This sometimes painful growth brought with it new confidence in the team's abilities to innovate at every opportunity. When it came to gameplay, the team wanted to address a couple of things they'd noticed about traditional first-person shooters, like how it was difficult to form an attachment with a character that you couldn't see. They figured the third-person viewpoint, coupled with the humor and interesting AI, would allow players to better engage with the characters and story. At the time, shooters weren't very popular with women, so by making these changes, they hoped to make the game more appealing to a wider demographic. A unique feature of Stranger's Wrath was the concept of live ammo that replaced conventional bullets with living creatures, each with their own distinct traits and appearance. The team had a lot of fun coming up with the different ammo types and their effects, like Stunks, which, when launched, would explode on contact, creating a cloud of green gas. Any enemy within range would then start throwing up. They wanted players to have fun putting the outlaws through misery, as opposed to simply killing them off. With it being such an important part of the game, it's no surprise that live ammo went through numerous revisions, both in terms of visual appeal and the degree of damage they'd do, as it was something the team wanted to get right. It started out a little too cutesy, so they toughened it up, added upgrades, and gave the player an infinite ammo type, the Zapflies, which could be used to hunt down other ammo types and enemies. Chipunks were another favourite within the team, and were one of the very first live ammos. They started with the idea of a bait and trap, and from there it evolved into a more twisted concept of messing with characters and getting rewarded for it. Live ammo turned Stranger's Wrath into more of a sandbox, which Lanning felt was missing from other games. He liked the idea of encountering a shootout, where instead of just merely shooting enemies, you'd have to outsmart them, trick them, etc., which made you feel more powerful and meant there were more choices available to you than just shoot them in the knee or shoot them in the head. The team hoped that live ammo, combined with the stealth elements and the ability to retreat by running fast, would result in prolonged shootouts that could go on for quite a while. Oddworld Stranger's Wrath released in January 2005, exclusively for the Xbox. The game received high praise from critics for delivering a gaming experience unlike anything on the market at the time, with it later going on to win numerous awards from multiple media outlets. Shortly after production ended, the team began prototyping a new title called Stranger Arena, which would have utilized the same mechanics as Stranger's Wrath, but had players going head-to-head with each other, combining multiplayer first-person shooting with third-person platforming. In games like Quake, Halo, and Call of Duty, you are either winning or losing, but there wasn't much strategy in between. More often than not, you'd end up losing to the person who'd put more hours into the game than you. Lanning wanted a more strategic method of play, something more akin to an RTS game, where quickness didn't always mean victory. However, the game never materialized, because what had become an unfortunate tradition for Oddworld, Stranger's Wrath didn't have a particularly great launch. The game was originally supposed to release on both the Xbox and the PlayStation 2, with their publisher EA handling the latter port, but the PS2 version was cancelled during development, and EA withdrew its marketing and promotional support for the game because it was no longer a multi-platform title. They reportedly chose to prioritise an upcoming James Bond game they were publishing, called From Russia With Love. As a result, Stranger's Wrath sold poorly, with it only managing to ship 600,000 units, when they really needed 1.6 million to break even. With Oddworld Inhabitants losing money on its development, EA tried to step in to acquire them, in what Lanning described as a hostile acquisition. But Oddworld flat out refused to sell, and decided that their best course of action was to shut down their game development studio instead. Before pulling the plug, Oddworld did have another title in the works, The Brutal Ballad of Fangus Clot, which utilised the Stranger's Wrath engine and revolved around a brand new character called Fangus. The game was intended to be much darker and more brutal than what had come before, with Lanning and production designer Raymond Swanland wanting to focus much more on the trials and traumas coming out of Eastern Europe, such as drug cartels and human trafficking. The game was expected to be set in a region of Oddworld that somewhat resembled Afghanistan. It was even rumoured to be called Fangistan, and would play on the dynamic of cats versus dogs. The plan was for the cats to resemble a Russian mafia, fused with United States propaganda, making claims about freeing up the region, when in reality, they're just there to rob and slaughter the place, leaving it as rubble, while the dogs find themselves fighting for scraps in a war-torn region, with Fangus being more in that dog category. Some pre-production work was done on the game, and it had even been announced prior to the closure of the studio, but development came to an abrupt halt when their new publisher, Majesco Entertainment, tried to alter the terms of their agreement. Oddworld was having none of that, so they decided not to move forward with that relationship, which ultimately led to Fangus being scrapped. Lanning also wasn't thrilled with where the game was heading. He wanted to give the team a chance to create their own game, but they didn't want to stick with Oddworld, and instead wanted to go with more human designs. Lanning lost interest in the project after this, but still let the team run with it, so long as it didn't take place on Oddworld. Then their publisher relationship crumbled, and that was that. Prior to the company's closure, they got a heads up that they should do a forensic audit on the accounting, to find out how much money they weren't being paid that they should have. Normally a developer doesn't have the funds to do this, because an audit can cost hundreds of thousands of dollars, but thanks to McKenna, who had more money than Lanning, they were able to do the audit. In doing so, it was made evident that millions of dollars had never been sent to them that were supposed to have been, but exactly who owed what was now unclear, because companies had been sold, acquired, and rebranded. Regardless of who owed what and when, they could now prove that they were owed money, which they used as leverage in a negotiation to get back the 49% of the company that they had given up with the original investor. Had they not done so, they likely wouldn't have been able to shut down the company. Oddworld Inhabitants officially closed its doors in April 2005. Lanning and McKenna kept the Oddworld name alive, but eliminated most of the team, and moved to Berkeley to begin work on a new massively multimedia project called Citizen Siege. However, in 2008, the project was ultimately cancelled due to the global financial crisis. That same year, Jeff Braun, co-founder of Maxis, announced that he was working with Oddworld Inhabitants on a brand new game. It was touted as having a cinematic quality on par with CGI-based films, and it was hinted that the game would release episodically, but that it might also take years to surface due to its slow production schedule. Oddworld Inhabitants also began a new foray into social media, with the creation of a new platform they called XMob, which allowed users to create virtual theatres where they could share and watch content with their friends in real time. Nothing ever came of these projects, however. It was also around this time when they began self-publishing Abe's Odyssey and Abe's Exodus on Steam, GOG, and PSN, which turned out to be surprisingly profitable, with both games managing to sell a combined 750,000 copies by September 2012. With the money they made from reselling their old games, they were able to invest in remastering both Stranger's Wrath and Muncher's Odyssey in HD. Helping them with this endeavour was Leeds-based developer Just Add Water, A longtime fan of the Oddworld series, Jaw founder Stuart Gilray was introduced to Lanning at the Game Developers Conference in San Francisco in March 2009 by a mutual friend. A couple of months later, Gilray received an email from Lanning asking if they'd be willing to help them go through their archives in search for specific materials. Then in April 2010, they were asked if they could do a port of Stranger's Wrath to PC, as another developer attempting this had let Oddworld down. After a couple of weeks looking at the code and reading some documentation that had been put together about the Xbox engine, they agreed to do it on the condition that they could make a PS3 version as well. They'd already done a couple of projects for the PS3, so they knew the machine quite well, and since they were already going to the trouble of bringing the game to PC, it only made sense to port it to consoles too. After receiving content approval from Sony in late July 2010, Jaw received contact from Microsoft in August, asking if they'd consider making an Xbox 360 version, to which they agreed. But in December of that year, Microsoft rejected the game on the grounds that it had already been released for the original Xbox. So in January 2011, Lanning got in contact with the higher-ups at Microsoft, who suggested pitching it as a games-on-demand title. So they did, but this also got rejected because the game needed to sell at least 1 million copies at retail to be considered. They were then told to do another submission, but when that was also rejected in January 2012, the team gave up on supporting the platform, as it became apparent that Microsoft wasn't interested in having Stranger's Wrath on their system, and were just stalling. Despite this setback, Stranger's Wrath HD sold well on PC, PS3 and Vita, with the game surpassing 250,000 units by the end of 2012, becoming number 1 in the UK and Europe for the Vita, and number 2 in the US, much to Lanning's surprise. Munch's Odyssey HD arrived shortly thereafter, and found similar success. With this newfound success, Oddworld Inhabitants had the funds to tackle a new project. They began polling their audience, and found that the majority of people wanted them to go back to their older 2D puzzle platformers, and remaster Abe's Odyssey in much the same way they had done for Stranger's Wrath and Munch's Odyssey. As the team started looking into it, they realised that instead of merely remastering the game, they could fully remake it using modern 3D technologies. Production on Abe HD, as it was known at the time, had already begun while work on Stranger's Wrath HD and Munch's Odyssey HD were still underway. Early on, they weren't entirely sure what they'd be doing with it, but they did know that they'd be starting from scratch in some respects, and that they weren't going to be relying on pre-rendered FMV transitions like the first game did. Instead, everything would be running in real time. During the game's initial planning stage, there were only around 5 or 6 of them on the team. They spent a couple of hours sitting around a whiteboard, writing everything down that popped into their heads. They also brainstormed a few possible solutions to some of the potential problems they thought they'd run into. A couple of things of note were the planned DLC, which included Sligstorm, a short bonus game where you played as a Slig, all of the levels from Abe's Exodus, levels from before and during Munch's Odyssey, extra wildlife temples and factories, as well as multiplayer DLC. Other noteworthy ideas included having characters with different height, colour and voice variation, having Madokans clean up your mess from your kills and rupture farms, increased character interaction with variation of responses and deeper response trees, and more gore and blood splatter. Though, Lanning insisted on no gratuitous gore. There was also a list in the top right of voice cameos they wanted to include in the game, such as Solid Snake voice actor David Hayter, who they had on board right from the start. On the 23rd of February 2012, Jaw announced a licensing deal with BitSquid, a game engine and technology developer based in Stockholm, Sweden. The game was originally going to be built in this engine, as it gave the team the ability to scale and iterate quickly. However, after 6 months, the team decided to switch over to Unity instead, due to the sheer amount of custom coding they had to do with the BitSquid engine. Unity's modularity and ease of use meant that they were able to get back to where they were before the switch in just 3 months, and its out-of-the-box console compatibility meant porting the game was considerably quicker and more intuitive. They wanted to push the game's animation fidelity quite a bit, with the gameplay and cinematics all being done within the engine. They were able to work directly with Unity on improving the fluidity of their dynamic animation and lighting systems, as well as certain things that the engine simply didn't want to do, like instantaneous quick saves. A couple of months later, on the 3rd of August 2012, Oddworld Inhabitants held a competition to determine what the game's final title would be. Within a week, they'd received more than 4,500 submissions, and a month later, at Eurogamer Expo 2012, the game was officially revealed as Oddworld New and Tasty, alongside some early gameplay footage. One advantage of sticking with 2D, despite using a 3D engine, was that they could dedicate a ton of resources to their environments, making them more like true Hollywood sets. They could also have more characters on screen, and the dynamic animation system meant they could tune every move at the character control level. They needed to write more routines, but Lanning really wanted more responsive Mario-like animation. Of course, the most noticeable improvement over the original game was its resolution, with it now running at native 1080p instead of half NTSC. This massive leap in fidelity meant the team could take a step back, dissect the visuals of the original, and see what they could do to make it all come alive. Rupture Farms was now a busy factory, with machinery grinding and chopping in the background. The temples were given a sense of depth and size, with wildlife going about their business. They were even able to go back through the original design concepts and pick out and use ones that were changed for Abe's Odyssey due to the limitations of 90s technology. Oddworld Inhabitants had archived all of the original game's assets at a virtually film-like resolution in 1997, which the team was able to use as a template when creating new assets for New and Tasty. This meant Lanning didn't need to sit down with them to explain how Abe should look, for example, because they already had the model on hand for reference. The original game's pre-rendered bitmap backgrounds were built to such a high level that they were able to bring all of them over from the original game to model dimensions, texture maps, etc. Having access to these original assets saved the team a tremendous amount of art direction, which is the normal process of building new assets. They also made use of asset stores, looking for people who had made good particle effects, who had royalty-free assets, and things of that nature. In doing so, they were able to find things that would have amounted to weeks of programming work for the team. They even credited the creators of the assets that they ended up using, which was not standard practice in the industry. Lanning wanted everyone who helped them, whether they were aware of it or not, to have some kind of special appreciation, because what they were doing in terms of contributing to a community toolset was really significant. They also decided to promote several indie games through the in-game billboards, which some fans took issue with, because they believed it went against the game's anti-consumerist message. However, it's worth pointing out that this wasn't the first time that Oddworld had promoted real-world products in its games. For the North American version of Munch's Odyssey, they partnered with Sobe, an American brand of teas, fruit juice blends, and enhanced water beverages owned by PepsiCo. Xbox had teamed up with several companies known for their pronounced hipness to help promote the Xbox brand in exchange for product placement in some of their games. The Health Up vending machines, or Vendos, that appeared in the game were replaced with Sobe vending machines as a result. Lanning was keen to embrace the indie game community and spoke enthusiastically about cross-promotion plans with developers 17-Bit and Switchblade Monkeys, pointing to an almost union-like spirit of mutual cooperation and support among independent studios. Unlike the original game, which used static flip screens, New and Tasty had the camera pan to show you more of the direction you're traveling in. By using a 2.5D perspective, they could enhance the game's sense of depth, whilst retaining the simplicity that people liked about the classic platforming. They added analog controls, a free-form approach to puzzle solving, and a less punishing gameplay style in an attempt to smooth out some of the original's rougher edges, and make the best game they felt was possible. However, these changes also led to a number of design problems they needed to solve. For example, in the original game, the fixed screens allowed players to assess future dangers by slowly creeping into the next area to scope it out. But when they started gameplay testing for New and Tasty, they noticed that players were just running headlong into danger because there were no longer any distinct boundaries. To address this, they made the camera tilt in the direction Abe was facing to allow for maximum viewing distance of the hazards you were approaching. While this worked as intended, it also broke shadowed areas that Abe needed to hide in, as he was never properly concealed. So they added steam vents, which were placed slightly further into the foreground than Abe, to fully obscure him from view. Another design problem they ran into was the sleeping slicks that had woken up. In the original game, you could just leave the screen and reset the puzzle, but in New and Tasty, the team needed to give slicks more AI, so that after a period of time, they'd go back to sleep again. They also added cues like the Z symbols to signal to players that sleeping slicks were ahead. They faced a similar problem with chance suppressors, as they used to activate if you were simply on the same screen. But in New and Tasty, this needed to be changed to an area of effect, with it lighting up to indicate to the player that they're in range of it. An area of effect was also added to some of the other in-game mechanics, like the levers, so that Abe didn't need to be in the perfect position to use them. It wasn't just gameplay revisions either, as the 2.5D perspective necessitated a number of level design changes as well, like in the stockyards after escaping Rupture Farms. In the original game, the motion sensors were simple flat beams of red light that were projected from a lens in the background. Their lack of depth meant they weren't going to work in New and Tasty, so the team created mechanical frames that slid along like airport metal detectors moving across rails. This read much better from all perspectives, with the red beams being clearly visible from sharp angles, flattening out to thin dark blocks when the camera showed them directly from the side. However, this solution also inadvertently changed the gameplay challenge of these sections, because, in the original, the beams of light moved at different speeds and could overlap each other, which was no longer possible in New and Tasty. The original game's hard difficulty was something that they were acutely aware of, and they wanted to remedy this by empowering players with choice when solving puzzles in New and Tasty. They wanted players to overcome obstacles with wit and clever solutions, as opposed to having a clear-cut way of doing things, which required trial and error to discover. They also added multiple difficulty settings, so that newer players could get the most out of the game, while still ensuring experienced players had that old-school difficulty if they wanted it. When adjusting the difficulty levels, it wasn't necessarily about making the game easier. Instead, it was more about making the gameplay experience more dynamic, where players aren't always punished for their mistakes. While originally slated for release in autumn 2013, Oddworld New and Tasty eventually released on the PlayStation 4 in July 2014, with a PC version and other platforms following thereafter. The decision not to release same day on PC stemmed from Lanning's concern with piracy. He'd heard from people he knew that games that released on console and PC simultaneously ended up being more commonly pirated, but if the PC version was delayed, people ended up picking up the console version and then maybe pirating the PC version afterwards. Lanning didn't want to risk jeopardizing PS4 sales by releasing same day on PC, so the PC version arrived later. New and Tasty was well received by critics, who praised the game for its creative puzzles, striking new visuals, and dynamic camera, but they had issues with both walking and running being mapped to the left analog stick, which occasionally led to imprecise platforming. The game was later patched to address this by adding options for dedicated run and hop buttons, reminiscent of the original game. New and Tasty was a financial success, with it receiving over 3.5 million downloads, which was a pleasant surprise for Lanning and the team. Following the game's release, a small subset of Jaw employees were given free rein to create a brand new level for New and Tasty called Alf's Escape, which was released as a DLC expansion pack. It was an entirely new section of Rupture Farms, designed to provide a hardcore challenge for those who enjoyed the original game's brutal difficulty. In Alf's Escape, players were tasked with rescuing Alf from certain doom. It was the first wholly original content made since Stranger's Wrath, and was made available a month after the game's release, in August 2014. Before the release of New and Tasty, Lanning told fans that if the game surpassed 250,000 copies, they'd remake Abe's Exodus next. Inevitably, New and Tasty blew past this number, and so, true to his word, they began early production on an Abe's Exodus remake called Oddworld Soulstorm in 2016. However, this time, Jaw would not be involved. Instead, Oddworld inhabitants shifted to a cloud-based development pipeline, with developers and studios around the world contributing to the game. Managing all of the different time zones was a fairly daunting task, but they managed to make it work. The primary reason for this change stemmed from Lanning's failing health. At the end of New and Tasty, he developed Bell's palsy, a condition that causes sudden weakness in the muscles on one side of the face. While he eventually recovered, it was clear that the arduous work and long hours had taken their toll, so they decided to bring most of the development closer to home, as Lanning's health was a major concern. This cloud-based approach meant they were better able to control costs, as they began operating more like film development, expanding and shrinking when necessary, and using all contractors. Traditional outsourcing companies weren't working out for them, because they wanted architectural specs, whereas Oddworld wanted contractors who knew how to build games, not people simply carrying out specific instructions. With the decision to remake Abe's Exodus firmly set, Lanning started looking back at the original game, and realised that instead of remaking it as it was, they could take this opportunity to tell the next part of the Oddworld Quintology, picking up where New and Tasty left off, but rewriting the old story to get back to what the original intent of the Quintology was. The big epic about a pacifist slave, who starts at the bottom and rises up to eventually lead a revolution that changes the world. While Soulstorm Brew would still be at the centre of things, that's where the similarities ended. Soulstorm would be much darker than New and Tasty, while still holding onto that classic Oddworld humour. It would be the biggest game they'd likely ever built, and would be much more sophisticated. A reboot, rather than a remake. Soulstorm was built upon the work Oddworld Inhabitants had already done with New and Tasty, though a lot of the technology ended up being redone. The game would feature new systems, mechanics, and physics to allow players to have more on-the-fly problem-solving and free-form traversal through dynamic environments. They wanted players to have their own unique stories about their playthroughs, and by taking a less static approach to puzzle-solving, they'd be able to increase replayability. They created new ways for players to exploit the environment, such as having Brew be highly flammable. Brew was always intended to function this way, even back in 1998. However, technological and time constraints meant the original team never had the chance to implement it. They added destructible floors and platforms to allow players to change up the playing field based on action, as they didn't want the environments to remain static. The team also built in RPG elements, empowering Abe with a lot more abilities and allowing him to accumulate and scavenge materials that could then be crafted into useful items to aid his journey. By doing this, they hoped to give the player greater agency and encourage more exploration of the world. The Modokans were given AI mob dynamics to make them feel more like allies, with aggressive and passive states, and crafted items could be gifted to your followers to allow them to fight or defend in a myriad of ways. The enemies were tuned so that you couldn't fight them head on, or if you did, it would be extremely difficult, so that players would be forced to outwit them instead. They also layered in Abe's ability to engage enemies at range, and enhance his possession ability, among other things, while Abe himself got a bit of a makeover. The two most noticeable changes were made to his eyes and ponytail. The former gave Abe and other characters a more relatable feel to them, while the latter was changed to be more in line with what Lanning imagined Abe should look like. With Modokans being descended from birds, it made sense for their ponytails to be made up of feathers, which are tough. In New and Tasty, they didn't really have the budget to go in and revitalize Abe's design, so Abe's ponytail ended up looking like a kind of dirty sock. While New and Tasty was a 2.5D game, Soulstorm took things a step further, with something they referred to as 2.9D. Instead of merely seeing pretty things in the background, the team pushed the Z distance all the way to the end, with everything visible being something you would eventually end up playing, what they called an epic path. To achieve this, they first laid out what they believed the epic path should be, in scale and scope. They then had their concept artist come in and paint over it to imagine the space and figure out what they wanted to have. All of this would be mapped in a kind of thumbnail sketch. They then layered that back into the epic path so that players could go through it. From there, they started placing all of the game design ingredients, such as crafting, exploration, stealth, or whatever the particular goals of that path were. Once that was locked in, and they'd found the fun elements, they began layering in the art. For the interiors, they needed to have constraints in place to make sure that whatever path they were carving aligned well with the vocabulary of that design. For the open exterior spaces, however, they could really open up on the 2.9D. The visible depth of an interior space was always gated by the walls, but the depth in exterior spaces extended out to the horizon. This new perspective meant that they also needed to spend a lot of time on their camera system so that it was more informative to the player. They called this more choreographed camera system Odd Scene, which they connected to something called Odd Walk. In layman's terms, this meant the gameplay would still be familiar and consistent with what players expected from a 2.5D game, but it'd be taking place in a fully 3D environment. This also meant that the code they'd written for New and Tasty wasn't compatible with what they were trying to do with Soulstorm. Had they known this ahead of time, they likely would have switched to a different engine that was more robust for AAA game development. Like its predecessor, Soulstorm was made in the Unity engine. However, everything was updated, with things like the fire and smoke trails being dynamically lit. The fire systems in particular were difficult to make performant, so they ran at whatever targeted frame rate the team wanted. Unity proved to be an excellent partner once again, as they supported Oddworld a lot, but the team still needed to write a lot of custom code to pull off everything they wanted. They were pushing Unity in places it hadn't gone before, and they were writing the latest versions of the engine so that they could help the Unity team implement features that benefited games like theirs, rather than just mobile games. They took advantage of multi-core processors with various thread optimizations that Unity wasn't doing because the mobile sector weren't demanding it. If they were sane, they'd have locked off the Unity version early in development and stuck with it, which is typical in game development, but if they'd done that, they wouldn't have been able to take advantage of all of the features they were having Unity implement on their behalf. They asked themselves how they could take something like New and Tasty and improve upon some of the elements that the fans thought could be better. But as they did that, they realized that they wanted to go further. They wanted to take advantage of the new technology available to them to make the game look more like a film, so they dialed up the expressive capability of the characters, which allowed the writing to be more subtle, and they played around with the scale relationship so that they could make the player feel small whenever they wanted them to see the world, while still having the player remain in control. They wanted the gameplay to hold up when you were close to the camera and when you were far away. The challenges with the Unity engine was only one of the problems the team faced. What compounded things further was that they weren't all in the same room. For the last year of the game's development, they had planned to move the team to the San Francisco Bay Area so that they could bring it all together in person in the last 18 months. But then 2020 came and threw a wrench into their plans. While in the studio together, they could make iterative changes quickly, like if something felt too fast, or Abe's attraction to a platform was too strong, etc. They could go through 20 of those iterations in a session in order to get it right, but because of lockdown, they were having to wait hours for new builds to be sent, only to realize that one of those iterative changes had been dialed back too much, requiring them to wait several more hours for another build. With so many touch points for people to tune, the iteration was just too slow. They tried many different things to resolve this, but in the end they had to turn it around and focus on what they could control without the team sitting beside them. Much like how New and Tasty released around the launch of the PS4, Soulstorm would leverage the PS5 to help sell the game. They knew there would be a lot of attention on the PS5, and so they thought about how best they could be a part of that. Gaming was now such an enormous industry that it was difficult to get visibility, so it was more important for them to do something clever to find success. They needed to do something special with Soulstorm that would make marketing departments eager to highlight it. Of course, at the very beginning of the project, the PS5 was nowhere in sight, but they still shifted internally towards focusing on the next big thing so that when it did arrive, they'd be ready. They wanted to see how far they could go with the console, so even though they didn't have the PS5 spec, they picked up some PCs that they thought were comparable and focused on maximizing the game's rendering and graphics. Then, to their surprise, they found that the PS5 actually exceeded a lot of their expectations. On the 11th of June 2020, during Sony's The Future of Gaming event, Soulstorm was announced as a timed PS5 and PS4 exclusive, with it being announced a few months earlier that the PC version would be a timed Epic Games Store exclusive. They did this so that they could get some additional funding to realize their creative ambitions and ensure Soulstorm would be at the highest level of quality. They also signed a deal with Sony to release Soulstorm for free via their PlayStation Plus service, something that Lanning later regretted doing as he believed it impacted the game's sales. They expected around 50,000 to 100,000 copies of Soulstorm to be claimed by the time of the game's launch, but it ended up becoming the highest downloaded game on PS5, with close to 4 million downloads. Lanning believed his studio missed out on potential profits due to the unexpected popularity of the game. After numerous delays, Oddworld Soulstorm finally released in April 2021 to mixed reviews, with the majority of the game's criticism stemming from the myriad of technical issues. The game's level design, variety in gameplay, and improvements to the series' mechanics received praise, however. An enhanced edition, which provided an additional level of polish, along with improved gameplay mechanics, motion code, new content, and ports for Xbox consoles, was announced in October 2021, and released a month later, with an optimized edition releasing for Nintendo Switch a year later. Oddworld Inhabitants has experienced many ups and downs over the nearly three decades since they were founded, but their unwavering resilience, determination, and passion for their craft has resulted in a uniquely beloved series that millions of people around the world continue to enjoy to this day. Over the years, there have been mentions of a number of other Oddworld projects that have yet to surface, such as Oddworld Slave Circus, which Lanning says he's done a tremendous amount of work on, despite rarely mentioning it, and that it would require a new level of console social integration for it to truly materialise. As for what the future holds for Oddworld inhabitants, that remains to be seen. If you enjoyed this video, and would like to support the work I do, then please consider checking out my Patreon, or becoming a channel member, where you can get exclusive access to new documentaries before anyone else, see monthly updates on the progress of whatever documentary I'm currently working on, and even have your name featured at the end of each documentary you funded. You can also send a one-time tip via Ko-fi, or a super thanks, if that's more your style. Click the card or the links in the description below.